Welcome to Salem United Methodist Church's Outdoor Worship Service. I'm Paula Overman, and this is our community time where we share announcements and prayer concerns. And we had a technical difficulty this morning. Larry Randall did a delightful job with community time, but we didn't catch it on tape. So that's why I'm making the delivery now. Larry pointed out something very important to us this morning. A big day in Indianapolis. It's 500 race day. And for Larry, a very unique race day because for the first time in 54 years, he's at church on race day morning. And he asked for other people in the congregation who had attended a race, and he was kind of doing a countdown to see who had been maybe as long as he. And the winner of that was Gene Seward, with over 30 years of attending the race. And I think Larry had a little token surprise for him after service is what was announced. Prayer requests are for Marla Ayler, daughter of John and Marianne Holmes. She has been diagnosed with type 1.5 diabetes. So prayers that she can manage that. Gerald Ramsey is going in for minor surgery, and prayers for the Sumner family. Tony Sumner passed away last Sunday from complications of COVID. The prayers for the Rogers family with the passing of Carrie Rogers, a local Zionsville family perhaps many of you may know. Prayers for the Long family. Reese Butler asked for prayers for Keziah Long and his family with the passing of Keziah's brother. prayers for the safety of those who are working on the restoration and repair of our Salem church building. And Ruth Thatcher asked for prayers for a classmate's brother, Jackson Kroger, who was sent to the hospital with a high fever. Nick Hipsky broke his wrist at football this week. He is to get it set on Monday. Hope that heals quickly for him. Prayers for the family and friends of Tony Sumner, who passed away last Sunday. Ruth and Rush Harmon are in need of prayers for strength and encouragement. Marge Curry has made it back home to Indiana. Continue to pray for her health concerns and praises for her that she is back home in Indiana where she wanted to be. We have a couple praises. Praises for the crew of people making our weekly outdoor service possible. Diane Ward sent her greetings and hello to everyone. She's doing well. Praises that the accident on Friday night that the Joe Overman family was involved in, there was no injuries that required anybody having to go to the hospital. So that's a praise. And I think that takes care of prayer concerns. Couple announcements. Danelle Butler shared that it is that time of year for the nominating of people to serve on the board and committees and trustees and fill vacancies. Please speak with Danelle about your willingness to take on one of these positions. And she also asked that if you are currently holding a position that you'd like to step away from, that you make her aware of that. Tuesday the 25th, there's a trustees meeting at 6:30. And currently, we have finished our Overcomer Bible study, and we'll be on a break from Monday night Bible studies until we get past Labor Day. So stay tuned for announcements on when Bible study will restart. Now let's tell some people happy birthday. Today is Jeff Ottinger's birthday and Ron Ho. On the 25th, Deneen Thatcher celebrates her birthday. On the 27th, Jay Gibson. On the 28th, Gail Klotz and Linda Miller. And on the 29th, Harry Bivens. And celebrating an anniversary today are Ruth and Rush Harmon. Thank you.
Hi, it's time for our call to worship. The Lord says, "Come all you who labor and are overburdened." He doesn't say, "Come all you Americans or Methodists or all you who look and act alike." But it's, "Come all." Let us worship the God who welcomes us all, and may we find unity in our diversity.
I love to tell the story glory of Jesus and His love. I love to tell the story because I know 'tis true. It satisfies my longings as nothing else can do. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus and His love. I love to tell the story for those who know it best. Same hungering and thirsting to hear it like the rest. And when in scenes of glory I sing the new, new song, 'twill be the old, old story that I have loved so long. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus and His love. To tell the old, old story of Jesus and His love.
It's now time for our Apostles' Creed. If you'll all help me through this, we'll recite the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day He rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now it's time for our Old Testament lesson. We start off with Exodus, book 1, verse 8, and read to book 2, verse 10. Then eventually a new king came to the throne of Egypt who felt no obligation to the descendants of Joseph. He told his people, "These Israelis are becoming dangerous to us. There are so many of them. Let's figure out a way to put an end to this. If we don't and war breaks out, they will join our enemies and fight against us and escape out of the country." So the Egyptians made slaves of them and put brutal taskmasters over them to wear them down under heavy burdens while building the cities of Pithom and Ramses as supply centers for the king. But the more the Egyptians mistreated and oppressed them, the more the Israelis seemed to multiply. The Egyptians became alarmed and made the Hebrew slavery more bitter still, forcing them to toil long and hard in the fields
and carry heavy loads of mortar and brick. Then Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, instructed the Hebrew midwives to kill all Hebrew boys as soon as they were born, but to let the girls live. But the midwives feared God and didn't obey the king. They let the boys live also. The king summoned them before him and demanded, "Why have you disobeyed my command and let the baby boys live?" "Sir," they told him, "the Hebrew women have their babies so quickly that we can't get there in time. They are not slow like Egyptian women." And God blessed the midwives because they were God-fearing women. So the people of Israel continued to multiply and become a mighty nation. And because the midwives revered God, he gave them children of their own. Then Pharaoh commanded all of his people to throw the newborn Hebrew boys into the Nile River. But the girls, he said, could live. There were at this time a Hebrew fellow and a girl of the tribe of Levi who married and had a family. A baby son was born to them. When the baby's mother saw that he was unusually beautiful, she hid him at home for 3 months. Then, before she could no longer hide him, she made a little boat from papyrus reeds, waterproofed it with tar, and put the baby in it and laid it among the reeds along the river's edge. The baby's sister watched from a distance to see what happened to him. Well, this is what happened. A princess, one of Pharaoh's daughters, came down to bathe in the river. And as she and her maids were walking along the river bank, she spied the little boat among the reeds and sent one of the maids to bring it to her. When she opened it, there was a baby. And he was crying. This touched her heart. "He must be one of the Hebrew children," she said. Then the baby's sister approached the princess and asked her, "Shall I go and find one of the Hebrew women to nurse the baby for you?" "Yes, do," the princess replied. So the little girl rushed home and called her mother. "Take this child home and nurse him for me," the princess instructed the baby's mother, "and I will pay you well." So she took him home and nursed him. Later, when he was older, she brought him back to the princess, and he became her son. She named him Moses, meaning to draw out, because she had drawn him out of the water of the Nile. This ends our reading from Exodus.
I like that version. That was pretty cool. Oh, goodness. Good morning, Salem. It's prayer time. And we've got prayer requests. We also have I've had conversations with people this week that are going through some things that really falls under the unspoken prayers. So throughout this week, God knows who they are, what they're in need of, and we know that we serve an awesome God that supplies our needs. Let us pray together. Oh Lord God, thank you for this beautiful race day. Thank you for this beautiful day that we can gather to worship you in truth and in spirit. Oh God, we thank you for being such an awesome God. We don't deserve all that you have blessed us. But Lord, you keep blessing us. And you keep blessing us. And you keep blessing us. Thank you, Lord, for that. God, we love you. And we know you loved us first. And Lord, allow us to allow your love to multiply within us that we can share with others. Oh God, there are those who are anxious right now, Lord. There are those who are depressed, Lord. There are those who are weary, Lord. There are those who really need you, Lord, right now, in the mighty name of Jesus. There are those among us who are ill, and there are those among us who still don't know what's going on. But God, you created each and every one of us. And the things of this world, the things of this world, the illnesses of this world, are of this world and not of you. God, let us uplift any of our own spoken prayers as we whisper them. And let us pray together as Jesus taught his disciples when we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its word that sounds like music in my ear. The sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. It tells me of a Savior's love who died to set me free. It tells me of his precious blood, the sinner's perfect plea. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. It tells of one whose loving heart can fill my deepest woe, who in its sorrow bears a part that none can bear below. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me.
Alrighty, this would be the time that we would collect our offering, and we're trusting and believing that those of you who mail in your check and do it electronically and or use the little box that's out there, we are going to go ahead and receive that. And I must be really sweet because these gnats are just driving me crazy. So let us accept the offering. Lord God, as we present our gifts of thanksgiving, we pray that through them that we may be instrumental in breaking through the barriers that divide us as we extend a hand that shares and heals. In the mighty name of Jesus we pray. Together we say, Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Good morning. Forgive my coughing. My sinuses are not cooperating with me this morning. Children, did any of you surprise me and memorize your memory verse from your Sunday school lesson? All right. That challenge is out there. From the book of Ephesians, chapter 4, verse 32. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Pretty cool to be forgiven for everything you've done wrong, isn't it? That's a pretty good verse. Go back and look at that one, all right? Okay. The gift of organization was not mine this morning. I didn't handle it well. I did not get here with all my sermon notes. So, if this sounds a little disorganized, forgive me. And I left my prop in my bag. Denise, there's a gold bowl in there. Will you bring it to me? All right, let's talk about Romans, the book of Romans, chapter 12, verse 1 through 8. It's about gifts. Gifts, y'all like gifts? Everybody like gifts? Ethan, do you like gifts?
Yeah.
You better say yes. Grandma and Grandpa are going to not maybe back off of their generosity. Specifically in chapter 12, verse 6, we have different gifts according to the grace given us. If a man's gift is prophecy, then let him use it in proportion to his faith. If it is serving, let him serve. If it is teaching, let him teach. If it is encouraging, let him encourage. If it is contributing to the needs of others, let him give generously. If it is leadership, let him govern diligently. If it is showing mercy, let him do it cheerfully. Now, how many of you feel that you have gifts that you share with others? Okay, good. I hope so. Does God give us our gifts to keep them to ourselves?
No.
No, 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 no. Not supposed to be selfish with those. Now, I have the offering plate because we pass this around normally in the pews, and you would recognize it as an offering plate, a giving plate to give cash to help the church, to build the church, to be missional. You can't put yourself in this plate, can you? But again, I say, that doesn't mean that you don't have a gift to give just because it doesn't fit in this plate. And you need to not forget to be giving. You need to give to, can you give to your parents? Now, Ruth, I saw that face. You can be helpful and cheerful and respectful to your parents, right? Can you give to your friends? What can you give your friends? You can give them back the friendship they're trying to give you. What can you give Jesus?
Your heart.
Your heart? I heard that. What else? Your life? Love? Those are good things. And I think that Jesus hopes that we are giving him those things. That's what we're meant to do. And do you feel like you're doing a pretty good job with that, giving yourself to Jesus? Okay. Why is that important? Who's Jesus? Why is it important to give him anything? I'm sorry? He gives everything to us. for us.
Died on the cross for us. Eternal life. I'm sorry, those doggone masks and my lousy ears, I'm struggling here. So, he gave us his life. He gives us salvation. He gives us love. He's a pretty important guy, huh? All right. So, I told you, I didn't have all my notes. Give of yourself. Give of your time and your talent. Give to, what is that? To make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. That's your job, and you've been blessed with a gift to help make that happen. So let's see you put those gifts to work for Jesus, all important, the Son of God. Okay. Thank you for your attention.
Amen. All righty. Our New Testament lesson comes this morning from Matthew, the 16th chapter, the 13th through the 20th verses. Hear ye now the word of the Lord. Now, when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptizer, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the other prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" And Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then Jesus sternly told the disciples that they were not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. My friends, this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Will you pray with and for me? Speak, Lord. Speak to me and through me. Almighty God, I truly thank you for another opportunity to break the bread of life this morning with my sisters and my brothers. Father God, I ask that you speak to us and fill us, Lord, with your precious Holy Spirit. And all of God's people said, Amen. If we take a look at our gospel lesson today, Jesus asked the disciples a question. He asked in verse 13, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And the disciples said, "Some say John the Baptizer, but others say you are Elijah. And others, even other folks, say you're Jeremiah or one of the prophets." Then Jesus asked the million-dollar question. In verse 15, he said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Salem, I understand that God designed each one of us uniquely, and our thoughts and personalities are all different. And that's a wonderful and beautiful thing, because it would be terrible to have 35 Ginas running around, you know? And, but after these 3 years, you all have been putting up with my crazy little idiosyncrasies and how I act a little silly sometimes and how I like to have fun in church, and you've put up with that. And sometimes I think you might even enjoy it. But I'm going to ask you a really serious, serious question right now. I'm going to ask you directly. I'm going to try and look at each one of your eyes, even through your sunglasses and even through your windshields. Who is Jesus? Ooh, I even hear some people back there. All right now. All right. Is Jesus that little bitty baby wrapped in swaddling clothing, lying in a manger, born in Bethlehem? Or is he really the young and great Bible scholar who knew the scripture very well? Is he the homeless guy who walked around from place to place, talking to people and making some kind of impression on them? Is he the innocent guy who was falsely accused of a crime and sentenced to death? Who do you say Jesus is? In your heart, I want you to make a list, and hopefully it can become a very nice long list of who Jesus is to you. Who is Jesus to this church? Who is Jesus to this community? Who is Jesus to this world? After I like to use Simon Peter's other name. After the bold Cephas, I like that name. If I had had another kid, I probably would have named him Cephas. And then he would have been mad at me because people would have made fun of me. But anyway, I like the name Cephas. And otherwise, he was known as Simon Peter. And Simon Peter boldly, I mean, dun, 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 you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. He said that with authority because he had been given authority by God to say that. And so Jesus told him, said, nobody here on earth has revealed this to you. Nobody else around here knows this but me. Well, his mama knew it too, but nobody knew that. So it had to have come from God. And Peter, because you know how to listen to God. Listen to God. How do we do that? Do we cup our ear to listen to God? Do we read our scripture to listen to God? Do we pray and wait for God to say something back to us? Can we just sit in our car or out on our back porch and just listen to nature and allow God to speak to us? Well, Jesus realized that Peter did listen to God. And so, with that, he said, Peter, upon this rock I build my church. In other words, he was saying, Peter, because you know how to listen to God, you will let nothing, no one, to be able to destroy my church, the big C. And I will make sure you have tools to do real ministry. I'm going to dub all of y'all Cephas because God gives us that too. God gives us all the tools to do real ministry. All we have to do is use them. Amen? All right. Well, we haven't been saying amen too much because we're not supposed to be talking all together, but that's okay. Jesus said, Peter, I got your back, man. And then Jesus says something that confuses a lot of folks in verse 20. Then he sternly said, do not tell anybody that he is the Messiah. What's up with that? Why would he say that? We know that right then Jesus wasn't ready for the world to know who he was. Do you think his death would have come earlier if folks knew that he was the Messiah? But he was supposed to die around Passover. There was a plan in place. And so Jesus didn't need that info being released too loudly. Like we didn't want the information of our friends released to everybody. So they understood, the disciples understood that Jesus was the Messiah. And in the Jewish culture, the Messiah was big, strong, rode in on a big old horse and was, you know, mighty. But how did Jesus come? During that time, getting ready to go to the cross, he came in on a little donkey. How mighty and powerful is that donkey? It was, and I mean, if we really look at it, it was, because it had never been ridden by anybody ever. And it was where we would see Jesus for who he was, meek and lowly. So, Jesus will tell the disciples what to expect from his messiahship. He will tell them what to expect with his death and resurrection. And Peter will protest mightily, receiving Jesus' sharp rebuke. And Jesus will not allow the disciples to reveal his messiahship that until they understood everything that was to happen. They won't really understand. They sort of didn't get it. But that's okay. They got it later. And when they saw the resurrected Christ, wow, could have had a V8. Then they were in belief. Now, as I close, I want to ask a few really hard yes and no questions. And this time, it's not because of COVID. I want you to answer it quietly in your heart. Are you truly committed to Christ? Have you seen the risen Christ in your life? Can Jesus depend on you to let the light of the large C church shine through you? Are you ready to meet the needs of those in the community at large? Are you ready to reveal the messiahship of Jesus to those who you meet? And here's a real hard one. Are you studied up, prayed up, and spiritually strong enough to handle the truth of Jesus? Do you really understand the real sacrifices of being a true disciple of the living Christ? My beloved, in your heart of hearts, if you answered no to any of these questions. It's time to figure out when we are going to change the answers to yes. Salem, who is Jesus? Let the world know. Amen.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares.
Thank you, Lord. And I'm not going to apologize. When the Holy Spirit hits you, the Holy Spirit hits you. And I have been praying so hard this week about the sermon. Whew, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Lord. Our benediction. May the Lord grant you convictions for the sake of truth. May he grant you toleration for the sake of love. And may he grant you wisdom to exercise each in its proper place. In the name, in the powerful, in the beautiful, in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen.
the zombies picking up speed. Down the back stretch, hear them roar. Into the deep lane on board. Cross the short stretch, flying low. Out of the north and straight to school. Down to the bridge, the charge is through. And here comes the plunderer. The opening till the race is done. It's thrill after thrill after thrill. The 500, the 500, the biggest and best of them all. And until that checkered flag's up first, it's the greatest, 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 greatest.
Fans, it's once again time for the traditional singing of Back Home Again in Indiana. And once again, it is my privilege to introduce to you Mr. Jim Neighbors.